The significance of dry fasting. First lesson, Matthew chapter 16 verse 21. From that time forth began Jesus to show unto his disciples how that he must go unto Jerusalem and suffer many things of the elders and chief priests and scribes, and be killed, and be raised again the third day. Second lesson, John chapter 2 verses 17 to 19. And his disciples remembered, it was written, the zeal of thine house hath eaten me up. Then answered the Jews and said unto him, What sign shewest thou unto us, seeing that thou doest these things? Jesus answered and said unto them, Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up. Golden text, Matthew chapter 12 verse 40. For, as Jonas was 3 days and 3 nights in the whale's belly, so shall the Son of Man be 3 days and 3 nights in the heart of the earth. Be born again. The 3 texts above deal on the issue of the 3 days dry fasting, observed in Brotherhood of the Cross and Star. Now, how many people in the world have participated in the 3 days dry fasting periods done in Brotherhood of the Cross and Star? Very many people are asking why a whole of 72 hours should be spent on fasting. A lot of people pray the dry fasting should not be observed often. Others even wish it should be stopped forthwith. Some would fast for the first 24 hours, and complain, they are human beings and for that reason, they stop. Some would fast for 2 days and nights, while a few endure to the end. As recorded in Matthew chapter 12 verse 40, our Lord Jesus Christ promised to remain in the heart of the earth for 3 days and 3 nights. This is why members of Brotherhood of the Cross and Star observe the 3 days dry fasting. For these 3 days and nights, no water is drunk, no food is tasted, bathing and brushing of teeth are not also allowed. Is this not 3 days and nights death? Whoever undergoes this fasting has died and resurrected with Christ. This is what is called, born again, for he or she has become a new being after the fasting. This is what is keeping us alive and strong. You would recall, God directed Abraham to take his son Isaac and sacrifice him. Abraham and Isaac were to make a journey of 72 hours, 3 days and nights, which is the same thing we are doing here in Brotherhood of the Cross and Star. Isaac was an earthly example, which was presented as an illustration of an impending heavenly event. The directive given to Abraham by God was a practical demonstration of the death of Christ and his subsequent stay in the grave for 3 days and 3 nights. This episode is linked with Abraham because of the promise, which God made with him, that a root shall spring from Abraham. In this promise, God did not say, Abraham's children but one son. That very son who shall come from Abraham, as promised by God was Christ. Now, the problem of the entire world is patience. God is the Father of patience. He is patient and wants us to exercise patience. He can make a promise today, which would take thousands of years to consummate. And for this reason, whoever is devoid of this virtue would become hopeless after the first 1,000 years. However, whether you believe or not, at the expected time, the promise must come to fulfillment. God does his things the way he likes. It is on this ground our Lord Jesus the Christ said, Think not that I am come to destroy the law, or the prophets, I am not come to destroy, but to fulfill. For verily I say unto you, till heaven and earth pass, one jot or one tittle shall in no wise pass from the law, till all be fulfilled. Matthew chapter 5 verses 17 and 18. The Holy Bible is referred to as the covenant book of God, because all what God did, what he is doing, and what he shall, are written therein. When you say, this or that thing had been taken away, where do you think such a thing is taken to? God is the Father of truth, and all his words are true. Once he makes a pronouncement, he stands by it. A great many of you become doubtful when things go the way you did not expect. Consider the case of Isaac. He was the only son of Abraham, but God directed that Isaac should be used as a sacrificial lamb. Abraham accepted, and though he had to trek for 3 days and 3 nights, 72 hours, he did not change his mind. When he got to the destination, he still set a fire on the altar to burn Isaac. This was, when Isaac asked his father Abraham saying Father, the fire is burning, where is the sacrificial lamb? Abraham said, My son, God will provide himself a lamb for a burnt offering. God is the one who sends one on an errand, and goes with the one to fulfill the purpose thereof. Since he is the sender and doer of the job, all glories and thanks belong to him. This is, why it is said, Cut down the bush, and I would set fire into it with my power. God controls destiny. God has never deceived and will never deceive. What he did to the Israelites would be done to the Gentiles. He is the same yesterday, today and forever. Why then do you doubt him, and why do you murmur against him? You have no choice other than to do whatever he directs you to do. If God asks you to jump into burning flames, you have to comply without delay. If he directs you to dive into the grave, you have to do the same. This is because in all events and situations, God had given answers already. What has placed a lot of you in suffering and adverse conditions is lack of faith. Many people, when they are sent on an errand by God, faithlessly doubt their safety during such missions. Why do you doubt God? Have you ever seen a person whom God sent on an errand without escorting him to get the job accomplished? The will of the Most High God is supreme. He had willed various purposes for all his creation. No one can change God's will, no matter how he fasts, prays, preaches, or weeps. He cannot change the will which he had destined for someone. This explains why it is said, "Take therefore no thought for the morrow shall take thought for the things of itself. Sufficient unto the day is the evil thereof." Matthew chapter 6 verse 34. It is only God who can call one to himself, for no one is capable of pleasing God. If he does not elect you, you cannot be his friend. Even the faith which Abraham had was not his, but it was freely given by God. I want you to know, God is a hydra-headed being. He is the right, left, front, back, and he is everything. He is a child, adult, women, as well as men. If Moses had this knowledge, he would not have whipped God the way he did, as recorded in Numbers chapter 20 verses 11 and 12. You may recall, when Moses was abused by the Israelites, for taking them away from Egypt to suffer in the wilderness, only because they were thirsty, and God became a big rock. Moses was directed to point his staff at the rock and speak, for water would come out enough for all the people, and their beasts. Since Moses was always easily exasperated, he took offense on the abuses and curses heaped on him by the Israelites, and smote the rock twice. For that reason, God was not pleased with him, because he did not glorify God in the presence of the people. He was therefore not allowed to enter into the promised land. Numbers chapter 20 verses 1 to 20. Moses did not know, both the rock and the water that gushed out of it were God in disguise. So, you can't see how incomprehensible the Almighty God is. No one knows him. And like the case of Moses, when Abraham had set Isaac ready for the sacrifice, God ordered him not to take the boy's life. He was shown a ram by the side, which was used for the sacrifice. Genesis chapter 22 verses 10 to 13. After the sacrifice, Abraham and Isaac went home in flying colors. That is the significance of the death of Christ. When he told the Jews to destroy the temple, and he would rebuild it in 3 days, the people doubted the possibility of his action and thus became annoyed. However, Christ knew the implication of his statement. And so when his disciples advised him not to go to Jerusalem, he insisted and went. If Jesus the Christ had ran away, what would have become of this world? And if Christ had truly ran away, could he have escaped the death which was written for him? People refuse to do what God directs because of fear. They prefer to stay in the world, yet they neither die nor live a successful life. They cannot even have peace as a result of their failure to endure the ways of God. And now, one can understand from the statements made by our Lord Jesus Christ, as recorded in the texts for this sermon, death does not actually exist, but what happened was a demonstration of the power of God. This was done so that His glory would be revealed. God is the one controlling one's destiny. Some children, for instance, even at their tender ages, proclaim they want to work for God. Do you think they are the ones making the statement? This was written for them before they were born into the physical earth plane. Unfortunately, when the time for this assignment to manifest comes, they then resist. This, however, cannot help the situation, because what has been destined cannot be erased. Whatsoever happens to one comes from the Father, and had been written against that person before he was born. There is nothing that can change or stop it from taking place. It may be recalled, on the night of the death of our Lord Jesus Christ, he said, "If it be possible, let this cup pass from me, nevertheless not as I will, but as thou wilt." Matthew chapter 26 verse 39. Did God grant his request on that very case? Though he prayed and rolled on the ground, until his sweat became blood, the cup was not taken away. Luke chapter 22 verse 44. Finally, the will of the Father, his torture, death, and resurrection manifested. The death of Christ for 3 days and nights reveals the person embodied in one God, as recorded in 1 John chapter 5 verse 7. For there are three that bear record in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost, and these three are one. Prophet Jonah was sent to Nineveh to preach to the people against their evil ways, but he ran away because of fear for his life. For that reason, the Father disguised himself in the form of a storm, and met Jonah in a ship, on the high sea. When the storm became unbearable, Jonah told the captain of the ship and others he should be thrown into the sea, for he was the cause of the impending wreck. Jonah was thus thrown into the sea, and immediately, a whale swallowed him, where he remained for 3 days and three nights, before he was delivered safely to the shores of Nineveh. Jonah chapter 1 verses 3-17, Jonah chapter 2 verse 10. For our Lord Jesus Christ to stay 3 days and nights in the heart of the earth was not a new thing. This is, because Jonah had earlier stayed for 3 days and nights in the belly of the whale. Did he not come out still as Jonah? Why then do people doubt the death and resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ? Daily, God is revealing a lot of things in various forms, yet, he is still the same God. A local adage says three is good but four is evil. This is another way of expressing the Trinity of God. 3 days, three houses, 3 years, everything three, Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost. The spiritual mathematics of God works well with the number three. The three persons in one God are not three gods but one. He was Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. God only answers different names for different occasions and missions. Also, our Lord Jesus Christ had 12 apostles, but three, Peter, James, and John, were completely distinct from the rest. These three were closer to him than the rest. We also have the body, flesh, spirit, and soul, which are also one, in one person. Whenever God wants to manifest himself as a human being, he takes up water, blood, and spirit, and these are one. 1 John chapter 5 verse 8. The change of name means nothing, but the power that goes with the name is important. Let it be known, when one baptizes, the water he falls into is Christ. He is also baptized in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Therefore, one has made a mistake by saying, God came on the persons of Adam, Enoch, Elijah, Noah, Melchizedek, Moses, Jesus the Christ or Lambrobu. You are thus declaring, he has come 8 times, which is wrong. Which God came 8 times? Is it the false God, or the living and omnipresent God? God came first as the Father, when he used the Word to create all things. He also used the Word for all works. Finally, he has come as the Holy Spirit to stay forever. In those days, all the prophets and their prophecies were about our Lord Jesus the Christ. And Christ bore witness to the Holy Spirit. He did not bear witness of any other being, not even the prophets, but testified of the Father. For there are three that bear record in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost, and these three are one. And there are three that bear witness in earth, the Spirit, and the water, and the blood, and these three agree in one. 1 John chapter 5 verses 7 and 8. That is why, in brotherhood of the cross and star, we always regard three things, faith, hope, and love, as being important. See the first lesson below. First lesson, Matthew chapter 16 verse 21. From that time forth began Jesus to shew unto his disciples, how that he must go unto Jerusalem, and suffer many things of the elders and chief priests and scribes, and be killed, and be raised again the third day. Christ died for 3 days and not two. From the above text, one should understand that our Lord Jesus Christ predicted a 72-hour death, no more, no less. Now, the worldly people believe that he was killed on Friday, Good Friday. Count from Friday morning to Sunday morning, is it up to 72 hours? Where are all their mathematicians? Has Satan not deceived them? If one adds up the days, he would see, from 6 a.m. of Thursday to 6 a.m. of Sunday, which he resurrected, the number of days are complete. Now count, from 6 a.m. Thursday to 6 p.m. Thursday, is the first day. From 6 a.m. Friday to 6 p.m. Friday, is the second day. From 6 a.m. Saturday to 6 p.m. Saturday, is the third day. Also, from 6 p.m. Thursday to 6 a.m. Friday, is the first night. from 6 p.m. Friday to 6 a.m. Saturday is the second night. From 6 p.m. Saturday to 6 a.m. Sunday, when Mary Magdalene visited the tomb to discover the resurrection, is the third night. These are therefore 3 days and three nights, or 72 hours. Matthew chapter 12 verse 40. So, if you have been joking with the number 3, do not joke anymore. In Brotherhood of the Cross and Star, there are also 3 Pentecostal periods. These are to signify the special number 3, Father, Son and the Holy Spirit, the most united Trinity, 3-in-1 God. The December Pentecostal Assembly represents the birth of our Lord Jesus Christ. The April or Easter Pentecostal is used to remember his period of persecution, tribulation, death and resurrection. The August Pentecostal represents the time which Christ baptized, received the Holy Spirit, and was revealed to the world. Now, are these 3 occasions not but one thing? These 3 things, however, cannot happen one day. It was not the day he was born that he died, and the day he died was not the very day he was baptized and revealed to the world. If you had known, just as Jonah was 3 days and nights in the belly of the whale, so also was our Lord Jesus Christ in the heart of the earth for 3 days and three nights. What stops you from doing this 3 days and nights dry fasting? This 72 hours dry fasting signifies the 72 hours death of our Lord Jesus the Christ. All those who do not respect or recognize these 3 periods are rebels. Such people will be judged and condemned. But all those who observe and recognize these periods, in truth, shall have eternal life. We have no other job to do for Christ than to worship him and honor his words. If the whole world would truly believe in the instructions of Christ and practice same, all burdens would be made light and all problems solved. Joke no more with the words of God and do not oppose, doubt, or ask him questions anymore. It was out of a doubtful mind Peter argued and rebuked our Lord Jesus Christ for saying he would be tortured and killed in Jerusalem. Peter said such must not take place, but Jesus the Christ said, "Get thee behind me, Satan, thou art an offense unto me, for thou savorest not the things that be of God, but those that be of men." Matthew chapter 16 verse 23. The fact Peter rebuked Christ did not stop the will of God from manifesting in him, as predestined. Why Peter rebuked him was, because, it was written that Christ would not die forever and so, if he is overcome by death, then, he was not the one. Therefore, for our Lord Jesus Christ to talk of death, Peter felt he had made a wrong choice by following him. Read the second lesson again. Second lesson, John chapter 2 verses 17 to 19. And his disciples remembered, it was written, "The zeal of thine house hath eaten me up." Then answered the Jews and said unto him, "What sign shewest thou unto us, seeing that thou doest these things?" Jesus answered and said unto them, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up." Man is the temple of God. Brethren, it is said, the testimony from 2 persons has established the truth of any case. By the statement, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up," Christ was referring to himself. He was asking the Jews to kill him and after 3 days, he would resurrect. The above statement by Christ is a proof to the fact, whenever the Almighty God passes an instruction, nothing changes it. That is why when his disciples started admiring the magnificent buildings of the temple, he made it clear to them, "The temple shall all be destroyed beyond repair." Matthew chapter 24 verses 1 and 2. A spiritual psalm says, "I will destroy the old and rebuild a new Jerusalem for you." If all the synagogues and temples were useful to God, why did it become necessary that Jesus the Christ should come? These places did not practice the injunctions of God, which necessitated the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. As such, Christ came to destroy all of them, and made the worship and dwelling place of God in the bodies of human beings. If any person builds a house or cathedral, and calls it the house of God, he is telling lies, for God dwells in man. This is why it is said, "The kingdoms of this world are become the kingdoms of our Lord, and of his Christ, and he shall reign forever and ever." Revelation chapter 11 verse 15. Now, the dwelling place of God is now with us, and he shall dwell with us forever. At John chapter 4 verse 21, our Lord Jesus Christ first told the Samaritan woman, "A time will come, when the Father will neither be worshipped in the mountain nor at Jerusalem, but that the true worshippers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth." At John chapter 14 verse 26, He also promised us, at the appointed time, the Comforter will come to teach everyone on how to worship God in spirit and in truth. By that time the Comforter, even the Spirit of Truth, had not come, and everyone worshiped God in the flesh. However, now that He has arrived, we have to worship Him in our bodies, not in a house, mountain, riverside or forest. Now, the New Jerusalem is being built. Brothers Ebb, Esah, Aquin, Eck and others are putting in their efforts to see its completion. In it, we shall stay to enjoy feast and sing praises to God, but His real house is your body. And whenever you undergo 3 days dry fasting, it is properly swept and kept clean for God to habituate. This is why members try by all means to participate in the exercise. Whoever fails to observe the dry fasting has himself to blame. See the golden text below. Golden text, Matthew chapter 12 verse 40. For, as Jonas was 3 days and 3 nights in the whale's belly, so shall the Son of Man be 3 days and 3 nights in the heart of the earth. Fasting purifies the flesh. When the disciples of John the Baptist asked our Lord Jesus Christ why His disciples do not fast, whereas they and the Pharisees do, He told them, "The children of the bridegroom cannot mourn when the bridegroom is still with them." He also assured them, "Once the bridegroom is taken away from them, then the children will start fasting." Read Matthew chapter 9 verses 15 and 16 for clarification. Accordingly, whoever is in the flesh cannot fast. As such, the Holy Spirit cannot indwell the house. Then will Satan, the evil spirit, come in and exist therein. Once the evil spirit indwells you, you cannot worship God in spirit and in truth. However, now the Holy Spirit, even the Father, has come to indwell in His house, you have to fast, so that the house may be the essence of the 72 hours dry fasting. Our Lord Jesus the Christ said through Brother Paul, "For our conversation is in heaven, from whence also we look for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall change our vile body, that it may be fashioned like unto His glorious body, according to the working whereby He is able even to subdue all things unto Himself." Philippians chapter 3 verses 20 and 21. Everybody has been changed, but no one knows they are changed, and to what extent. Being changed, therefore, you are not wearing the old weak body anymore. You are now clothed with power and life. Our Lord Jesus Christ Himself bore witness of this fact, when He said, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believeth on me, the works that I do shall he do also, and greater works than these shall he do, because I go unto my Father." John chapter 14 verse 12. Have you not seen the work which is greater than all the works done by Christ? The entire world is a witness to the great works done by Christ. The Father has come as a thief in the midnight, so the worldly kings and so-called wise men are dumbfounded and mesmerized. For the fact, the Holy Spirit is here with us, we have no importance attached to houses, cars, wealth, food or money, but what is important to us is the new kingdom of God. The good news of the kingdom should be spread to all parts of the universe. We have to reveal the kingdom to all creation. The new kingdom has now been revealed to the entire world. Just as Jonah stayed in the whale's belly 3 days and nights, so did our Lord Jesus Christ remain in the heart of the earth for 3 days and nights. Likewise, Brotherhood of the Cross and Star fast for 3 days and 3 nights, without eating, drinking, bathing or brushing of teeth. Therefore, all those who participate in the dry fasting are followers of Christ, and have crucified the flesh with all its lusts and passions on the cross. They have forsaken all types of carnalities and welcome the Holy Spirit. Galatians chapter 5 verse 24 states, "And they that are Christ's have crucified the flesh with the affections and lusts." One can only crucify the flesh through fasting. Whether the world likes it or not, the flesh must be crucified to allow the Spirit to take dominion. Even as Jonah and Jesus the Christ spent 72 hours each at that state of temporary death, all humanity have to die with Christ for 72 hours, and also resurrect with Him. If we die with Him, we shall resurrect and be saved. During these fasts, all the choristers in the universe in all planes, spiritually and physically, are here together and sing melodious songs to the Holy Spirit. They should stay throughout the period to rejoice with God. Very soon, people will be coming from all parts of the world to stay with the Father and participate in this 72 hours of dry fasting, and those who were with various illnesses will be made whole. May God bless His holy words. Amen. Thank you, Father.